Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. We give you praise, glory, and honor, King Jesus, asking you that you would fill us with your word, teach us great and mighty things that we do not know. If there's anyone out there who does not know you, we pray that they would hear a word from you through the power of the Holy Spirit, so that they would repent and believe the gospel, because the time is short. Your coming is nearer today than when we first believed. So may we continue to watch and pray so that when you do come, we will be accounted worthy to stand before you, the Son of Man, and escape all the things that are about to come on the earth. In Jesus' name, I pray and ask it all. Amen. Hallelujah. So today we will be talking about when the temple in heaven opens, everything will change. As this current series is titled. And today I want to talk about the 70 years, hallelujah, the 70 years where God has repeatedly, in types and shadows, referenced the 70 years is still applicable to our day and age, hallelujah. We know that in the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, the 70 years were related to the judgment of captivity upon the Jewish people. But that judgment upon the captivity of the Jewish people is still relevant to this very day. Hallelujah. And we know that it's still relevant to this very day because of all the signs that God has given us in our day and age. Once in a lifetime signs, not just one or two or three, but multiple once-in-a-lifetime signs that God has given to this last generation, which is pointing us to the time that we are in now, where we today are closer than we were yesterday to the fulfillment of the 70-year landmark. And we know that when the 70 years are fulfilled, something dramatic is going to happen. And that something dramatic is what Isaiah 66 verse 15 says, "For behold, the Lord will come with fire and with his chariots, like a whirlwind, to render his anger with fury and his rebuke with flames of fire." So today I want to look at some things which help to point us to this time that we are in now, based upon the biblical scriptures. And our text will be Zechariah chapter 1. Hallelujah. And the 70 years that are connected to this prophecy. Here we start in verse 7 of chapter 1. "And on the 24th day of the 11th month, which is the month of Shabbat, in the second year of Darius, the word of the Lord came to the prophet Zechariah, the son of Berechiah, son of Iddo, saying, I saw in the night, and behold, a man riding on a red horse. He was standing among the myrtle trees in the glen. And behind him were red sorrel and white horses. Then I said, what are these, my lord? The angel who talked with me said to me, I will show you what they are. So the man who was standing among the myrtle trees answered, these are they whom the Lord has sent to patrol the earth. And they answered the angel of the Lord who was standing among the myrtle trees and said, we have patrolled the earth, and behold, all the earth remains at rest. Then the angel of the Lord said, O Lord of hosts, how long will you have no mercy on Jerusalem and the cities of Judah, against which you have been angry these 70 years? Hallelujah. So here we see that this rider on the red horse is riding on the 24th day of the 11th month, which is the month of Shabbat, in the second year of Darius. And he gives his report that all the earth remains at rest. And in my last teaching, we went over this report and how it was just fulfilled last week. But let's go ahead and revisit that again. We see that the 24th of Shabbat was Friday, February the 9th, 2018. Today is Monday, hallelujah. Today is Monday, February 12th, when I'm making this recording. So just last week, the report from the rider on the red horse went in. And that report was that the whole earth remains at rest. Hallelujah. Let's see it again. The rider on the red horse says in verse 11, "We have patrolled the earth, and behold, all the earth remains at rest." Now we have to understand some things. The word of God is living. The word of God is alive. The word of God is not stagnant. The word of God pierces even to the dividing of soul and spirit, joint and marrow, okay? This word of God still speaks to us today. The ancient Hebrews, said that there were four levels of interpretation, four levels of Hebrew exegesis, hallelujah. And let us look at that right now. Jewish exegesis, the title of it was Pardes. The four different levels were Peshat, Remez, Darash, and Sod. And the ancient Hebrews said that the word of God contained four different levels of meaning. Hallelujah. But I believe it even extended past these four levels, because who can understand the mind of God? Hallelujah. The mind of God cannot be contained. Every time you try to put God in a box, he's going to break it out. He's going to break out of it. Okay, God can't be put in a box, okay? The Bible tells us that, behold, even the heavens of heavens cannot contain God, okay? So his word is from everlasting. It's for all. It's always going to be settled in heaven, okay? His word extends beyond our human finite understanding. That's why we have to understand that when we come to the word of God, there's always something to know. There's always something to understand, because the word of God is alive. Therefore, we can understand that what was written before, especially in the Old Testament, was written for our learning, hallelujah, in types and shadows for our day. And I believe the types and shadows of our day is being played out right before our eyes, especially with in regards to the 70 years, because the 70 years is a major milestone, hallelujah. The 70 years is a major milestone, hallelujah. We know that at this time, when this was written in the days of Zechariah, hallelujah, we know that the Jewish people had went into captivity because of their disobedience. They went into captivity in Babylon. And we see that here in Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 25, we read this. "The word that came to Jeremiah concerning all the people of Judah in the fourth year of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah." That was the first year of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. "Which Jeremiah the prophet spoke to all the people of Judah and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem for 23 years. From the 13th year of Josiah, the son of Ammon, king of Judah, to this day, the word of the Lord has come to me, and I have spoken persistently to you. But you have not listened. You have neither listened nor inclined your ears to hear, although the Lord persistently sent to you all his servants, the prophets, saying, 'Turn now, every one of you, from his evil way and evil deeds, and dwell upon the land that the Lord has given to you and your fathers from of old and forever. Do not go after other gods to serve and worship them, or provoke me to anger with the work of your hands. Then I will do you no harm. Yet you have not listened to me, declares the Lord, that you might provoke me to anger with the work of your hands to your own harm. Therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, because you have not obeyed my words, behold, I will send for all the tribes of the north, declares the Lord, and for Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant, and I will bring them against this land and its inhabitants and against all these surrounding nations. I will devote them to destruction and make them a horror and a hissing and an everlasting desolation. Moreover, I will banish from them the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride, the grinding of the millstones and the light of the lamp. This whole land shall become a ruin and a waste, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years. Hallelujah. So before we keep on going on, let's break this down. You see, Jeremiah the prophet, when this was written, he said in verse 3 that for 23 years he had spoken to the southern kingdom of Judah about repentance and turning back to the Lord. And the children of Israel had not listened to Jeremiah nor any of the Lord's servants, the prophets. They did not want to turn from their evil way. They did not want to listen to what King Jesus, at that time they knew him as Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, was saying to them. And so the message from Jeremiah was that judgment was now going to come. And we know that the captivity began in this same year, the first year of Nebuchadnezzar. He came against Judah, and he took away some of the first captives in the year 605 BC. That's when Daniel was taken captive, hallelujah, the Babylonian captivity. The year 605 BCE, Jehoiakim began paying tribute to Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, and some of the young nobility of Judah were taken to Babylon. This was when Daniel the prophet was taken to Babylon in the year 605 BC. And this is exactly when Jeremiah gave this message. For 23 years, he had been speaking up until this very moment. So now God was going to come in judgment. And because the Bible works in types and shadows, it's very interesting about these 23 years. If we go back 23 years from today, 23 years from today, we get to 1994. Hallelujah. 1994, 1995. And what happened then, 23 years ago? Look what God did 23 years ago to wake us up. He sent Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9. Hallelujah. I did a teaching on this in one of my earlier teachings. You can go back and look in the descriptions and find that video. I'm not going to go in depth about this. But 23 years ago, from July 16th to July 22nd, 1994, this Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, slammed into the planet Jupiter. 21 total pieces, hallelujah, 21 fragments hit the planet Jupiter in 1994. And if we look at July 22nd, 1994, on the Hebrew calendar, we get that day was a Friday, 22nd of July, 1994. That was the 14th of Av, the year 5754. Hallelujah. If we take our calculator and we add 23 years, we add 23 years to 5754, hallelujah, this is what we get. 5754 plus 23, we get the year 5777, which is still this year. Remember that it's not the year 5778 yet. The year 5778 doesn't come until the first of Nisan, according to Exodus 12. This is what the Bible says. Exodus 12, verse 1. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall be for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you." Okay, so the beginning of months, the first month of the year, is the same year that is the same month that the Passover is. And the Passover begins in the month of Nisan. The month of Nisan is usually March or April, and this year is going to be March. Hallelujah. So it's not until March of this year that the calendar, according to the one that God said the Hebrews were to keep throughout their generations, it's not until this coming March that the year will switch from 5777, 5777 to 5778. Okay, so we're still in the year 5777. Hallelujah. And 23 years ago, hallelujah, it was the 14th of Av, 5754. From the date when the last fragment of the comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 slammed into Jupiter, which was on the 22nd of July, 1994. 23 years ago, in the Hebrew year 5754. Hallelujah. And so this is important because, as we read in the Bible, hallelujah, for 23 years, the prophet Jeremiah, hallelujah, had pleaded with the nation of Judah, the southern kingdom of Judah. For 23 years, he had pleaded with the people, hallelujah, to repent and to turn back to the Lord. But they refused to repent. And so, when those 23 years of was up, at the time he wrote this, the 70 years began. The beginning of the captivity began when King Nebuchadnezzar first came against the southern kingdom of Judah in 605 BC. And he carried away some of the nobles, some of the young princes, which included Daniel the prophet. And so God has given us a 23-year warning as well. Hallelujah. You see, because Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 was just one of the signs. Hallelujah. It was one of the first major signs. Hallelujah. One of the first major signs that God had given us in the heavens in regards to Luke 21:25, in regards to the end times. God said this in regards to the end times. There will be signs in the sun, the moon, and stars. And on the earth, nations will be in anguish and perplexity at the roaring and tossing of the sea. Okay, so the signs in the sun and the moon and the stars have been going on in hyper succession in our day and age. Hallelujah. Because Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, 23 years ago, was just the beginning of it. And those 21 fragments, hallelujah, if each fragment represented a year, those 21 fragments brought us to 2015, hallelujah. If we take 1994 plus 21, a year for each of the 21 fragments, we get 2015. And what was Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 pointing us to? Well, in 2015, it was pointing us to this. Hallelujah. The four blood moon tetrad. Hallelujah. 2015, we saw the sun darken on Nisan 1, on the Rosh Hashanah, on the biblical new year from Exodus 12. The sun was darkened. Hallelujah. And then we had two more blood moons to complete the four blood moon tetrad. Hallelujah. So Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, the 21 fragments that hit Jupiter, if each fragment represented a year, it pointed us to the four blood moons and the solar eclipse that occurred in 2014, 2015. Okay. And we know that this heavenly sign, whenever the four blood moon tetrads occurred in history past, we know that major events always surrounded them regarding the nation of Israel. We see that the last time these four blood moons appeared in history, four blood moons that all happened on Jewish feast days. Every time they happen, hallelujah, something major happened with the nation of Israel. In 1967, 1968, the last time it occurred, this was in regards to the recapturing of the ancient capital of Jerusalem. Hallelujah. And then before that, in 1949, 1950, the four blood moon tetrad was in regards to the nation had just become a nation again in 1948, May 14th, 1948. Hallelujah. And then before that, we have to go all the way back to 1493, 1494. And the year before that blood moon tetrad was the Spanish Inquisition where all the Jews had to flee from Spain, as well as the New World being discovered by Christopher Columbus in 1492. Hallelujah. So the 2014-2015 Blood Moon Tetrad was another major sign, hallelujah, that God was going to give us in regards to the coming of the cloudy day, hallelujah. And that day has already come and passed, but that's not all. What other signs have God given us since that time? Because it's been going on a little bit over 2 years since that time. So it's been 23 years since this, going all the way back to the comet Shoemaker-Levy 9. Okay, so 21 years from this comet, Shoemaker-Levy 9, we get to the blood moons, hallelujah. And then 2 years later, after the blood moon tetrad, we get this. We get the Great American Solar Eclipse. Okay, the Great American Solar Eclipse happened on August 21st, 2017. The Wikipedia entry says, prior to this event, no solar eclipse had been visible across the entire contiguous United States since June 8th, 1918. Okay, so this is another once-in-a-lifetime event. Another once-in-a-lifetime event. And it just happened last year. It just happened last year, 2017, but it was still the year 5777 on the Jewish calendar. Hallelujah. So we're within the 23 years, from comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, which again is in regards to the 23 years that Jeremiah had preached to the southern kingdom of Judah before the judgment came. Hallelujah. So I'm trying to tie this all into the types and shadows in the Bible that are playing out in our day and age. Hallelujah. But that's not the only thing. Okay, the solar eclipse of August 21st, 2017, which was a once-in-a-lifetime event, hallelujah, a once-in-a-lifetime event that cut America in half, started on the 33rd nation of Oregon, the 33rd state of the Union, which was Oregon, and it cut a diagonal path straight across America, and it ended on the 33rd parallel, hallelujah, which was in South Carolina. This is what it looked like from Simpsonville, South Carolina. And it also, the duration was 1 hour and 33 minutes, and it went through seven cities in America that had the name of Salem. And we know that when it ended out here, touching no other nation, a couple days later, the hurricane started to come to America. Hurricane Harvey and Maria and Joseph, hallelujah, they all came and they battered America. Okay, so this was a once-in-a-lifetime event, okay? A once-in-a-lifetime event, okay? Just like the Blood Moon Tetrad was a once-in-a-lifetime event. Just like Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 was a once-in-a-lifetime event. A once-in human history type of event for Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, because this was the first time in human history that mankind had ever observed two solar objects slamming into one another. Okay? Never before had an object in space been observed slamming into another object, okay, until this event, okay, until Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, the first time in human history that human eyes had ever seen a comet hitting another planet, okay? So this is a once in human history event, okay? The four blood moons, once in a generation event, the solar eclipse over America, the first time that a solar eclipse had crossed the entire United States since 1918, 100 years, pretty much, 99 years. Okay, this is a once-in-a-generation event. And then what else? And then we had another once-in human history event on September 23rd, 2017. We had the great sign in heaven from Revelation 12, verses 1 and 2, which says, "And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she cried, And she, being with a child, cried, travailing in birth and pain to be delivered. Okay, so this sign has appeared already. Okay, it appeared last year on the 23rd of September, 2017, a once in human history event, okay, that perfectly matched what the Bible said in Revelation chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. And we know that right after the next verses is the red dragon who appears. And then also the catching up of the man-child who the woman gives birth to, okay? And the man-child is caught up unto God into his throne, which is the rapture. So the same time that the dragon appears and he casts out the one-third of the heavenly hosts is the same time that the body of Christ is taken up into the throne room of heaven. Okay, we're taken up into the Father's house. Okay, this is what's going to happen next. Hallelujah. But there's signs that precede this, okay? There's signs that precede the trouble that comes on the earth, which we're going over right now. But this isn't it. There was other signs. Hallelujah. We just had one a couple last month. Hallelujah. We had the super blue blood moon, okay? The super blue blood moon on January 31st, 2018. For the first time since 1866, three lunar phenomena occurred at the same time, okay? It was a rare occurrence that included a total lunar eclipse, a super moon, and a blood moon. Okay, this is another once-in-a-generation event. So we had the super blue blood moon, a once-in-a-generation event, the great sign in heaven, a once-in-human-history event. We had the great American solar eclipse, a once-in-a-generation event. The four blood moon tetrad, a once-in-a-generation event. And we had Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, a once-in-human-history event. Okay? These are signs that have all manifested in our day and age at this time, okay? Within this generation, hallelujah, the generation of the end, the generation that Jesus was speaking to in Luke 21, verse 25. There will be signs in the sun and moon and stars, okay? The signs of the times have been speaking to this generation like no other generation in human history, okay? And so the point of all these signs is to wake us up, okay? Because just like the Old Testament type that we're reading in Jeremiah, for 23 years, God has given us signs, okay? For 23 years, God has given us heavenly signs, hallelujah. For 23 years, God has been giving us signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars. But has the world repented? Has the nation of America turned back to God? Has the world stopped its abortions? Has the world stopped its pornography? Has the world stopped its murder? Has the world turned back to the true and living God? No, 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 and no, okay? The world has gotten worse, okay? The world has gotten worse since Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 slammed into Jupiter in 1994. The world has gotten worse since 1994. It has not gotten better. For 23 years, there's been no repentance based on the type and shadow. For 23 years, there has been no turn to God. Hallelujah. There's only been a continuance of the rebellion, a continuance of the falling away, a continuance of the church of Laodicea rising in this world. That church that says that it's rich and it needs nothing. The church that says that it has everything because it has money. Okay, the church that says wealth and prosperity is a sign of God's favor and blessing. Okay, But we know in the book of Revelation that that final church, the seventh church, is rebuked and vomited out of Jesus' mouth, because while it thought that it was rich, while it thought that it was that it could see, Jesus said that that church was blind, that that church was naked, and that he said, I counsel you to buy of me gold tried in the fire. Okay, Jesus told that church to buy from God gold. Okay, who can buy gold from God? No one can buy any gold from God. God can't be bought with a price. Okay, no one can bribe God for some gold. Okay, God gives us everything that we need. Okay, he's the one who has it all. Okay, and so the church of Laodicea, which we see is the church of our day and age, the final church, that is the church that will be spit out of his mouth into the great tribulation, as well as all the other churches which are still alive and well today, that do not watch, like the church of Sardis, or who commit sexual immorality, like the church of Thyatira. All those churches are alive and well today, but the church of Laodicea is the dominant church at the end time, which is our day and age right now. And so when we go back to Jeremiah chapter 25, hallelujah, we see that once the 70 years are over, you see this is a double prophecy in Jeremiah chapter 25. Okay, so remember, there's layers and layers and layers of this. This word is alive and it's living. It's active, okay? This word is talking to us today, okay? Just like we just went over these 23 years. Once these 23 years had completed in Jeremiah's day, when he wrote this, the judgment began. The 70 years began, okay? In 605 BC, the first captives were taken to Babylon. Right when these 23 years were up. So the shadow to our day is that it's been 23 years. It's been 23 years since Comet Shoemaker Levy 9 slammed into Jupiter. And God has given a sign after sign after sign in the heavens that the time is short now. Okay, because we've had an uptake of signs the last 2 or 3 years. The last 2 or 3 years since the Blood Moon Tetrad, we've had a multiplicity of signs, okay? But the comet, Shoemaker-Levy 9, which started in 1994, which came in 1994, it pointed us with the 21 fragments. Each fragment represented a year. It pointed us to 2015, right in the middle of the Blood Moon Tetrad. And then once those 23 years were up in Jeremiah's day, the 70 years began. Okay, we read this in verse 11. He says that this whole land shall become a ruin and a waste, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years. So the 70 years began once the 23 years had been completed. Okay, for 23 years, Jeremiah preached. For 23 years in our day, God has given us sign after sign. If we're counting from Comet Shoemaker Levy 9, which happened in 1994. Okay? But then look at the double prophecy in Jeremiah 25. You see, because it's also speaking about the end of the 70 years. Okay? In verse 12, Jeremiah 25, this is what God says. Then after 70 years are completed, I will punish the king of Babylon and that nation, the land of the Chaldeans, for their iniquity, declares the Lord, making the land an everlasting waste. And I will bring upon that land all the words that I have uttered against it, everything written in this book, which Jeremiah prophesied against all the nations. Look at what he just said. Don't miss this. God said that at the end of the 70 years, okay, in Jeremiah's day, he was talking to the end of the Babylonians, when once the children of Israel had served for 70 years in Babylon, okay, God was going to punish the king of Babylon, which he did through the Medes and the Persians, okay? When Daniel, he was inside the feasting hall with Belteshazzar, he saw the handwriting on the wall, and he interpreted for the king of Babylon, many Tekel Upharsin, okay? And he interpreted that, and he said that the kingdom of Babylon was divided and given to the Medes and Persians. Okay, so in that day, this was fulfilled. When Babylon was captured in the night, you know, once the Medes and Persians took over Babylon, that very night that Daniel saw the handwriting on the wall, the 70 years were completed and the king of Babylon was punished because the king of Babylon died. Belteshazzar died, hallelujah, that very night, as the book of Daniel tells us. You see, but this goes beyond the time of Daniel, okay? Because he's speaking about Babylon the Great as well. You see, because once the 70 years are over, hallelujah, he's gonna make the land of Babylon an everlasting waste, and he's gonna bring upon that land all the words that I have uttered against it, everything written in this book which Jeremiah prophesied against the nations. Okay, so he's speaking of a far away time. Remember, prophecy has a near fulfillment and a far fulfillment. Okay, so the near fulfillment was fulfilled when the Medes and Persians came and destroyed Babylon without a fight the night that the writing on the wall appeared. Okay, that was fulfilled. But everything that was written against Babylon was not fulfilled. Okay, so that means that there is a far fulfillment that still has to be fulfilled. Okay, that's why we read closely in verse 13. Jeremiah says, I will bring upon that land all the words that I have uttered against it. Everything written in this book, okay? Everything written in this book, which Jeremiah prophesied against all the nations, okay? So he's talking about the end times. He's talking about Babylon the Great. He's talking about the cloudy day. When God brings everything written in this book to pass, okay? When God brings upon the land all the words that he had uttered against it, okay? You see, the destruction of Babylon in Jeremiah chapter 50, hallelujah, was not completed in the days of Daniel. When the destruction of Babylon came, hallelujah. We read about this here. Daniel chapter 5, hallelujah. The handwriting on the wall. Okay, when this happened, hallelujah, we read this. Verse 29. Well, let's read about the handwriting on the wall. Then was part of the hand sent from him, and this writing was written. And this is the writing that was written. Many, many, Tekel, Upharsin. This is the interpretation of the thing. Many, God hath numbered your kingdom and finished it. Tekel, you are weighed in the balances and are found wanting. Peres, your kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and Persians. Then commanded Belshazzar, and they clothed Daniel with scarlet and put a chain of gold about his neck and made a proclamation concerning him, that he should be the third ruler in the kingdom. In that night was Belshazzar, the king of the Chaldeans, slain, and Darius the Median took the kingdom, being about 62 years old, 62. Okay, so this night, the king of Babylon was slain. Okay, so that was just the first part of the prophecy. But if we keep on reading in Daniel, we know that Daniel still lived in Babylon. Because Daniel was still inside Babylon when the lion's den happened to him. When Daniel was thrown into the lion's den, Daniel was an old man. This was after Babylon had been defeated, but he stayed in Babylon. He didn't return back to the promised land. Daniel didn't return back to the nation of Israel. He stayed in Babylon. And Darius set Daniel over the whole kingdom. Okay? Daniel was set over the whole kingdom of the new kingdom of the Medes and Persians, where Babylon was Daniel's residence. And Daniel was in charge. And we get the famous story of Daniel and the lion's den in Daniel chapter 6. So I say all that to say this, because if the Bible says that God is going to make an everlasting waste to Babylon, that everlasting waste wasn't completed in the days of Daniel. Okay? If God says he's going to bring all the words that I have uttered against Babylon, that wasn't completed in the days of Daniel. If God said everything written in this book is going to be completed against Babylon, that wasn't completed at the time that Babylon was captured after the 70-year captivity. That means that this has a far fulfillment. You see, because we read about the total destruction of Babylon in Jeremiah chapters 50 and 51. We'll just take a couple looks at some of the verses where utter destruction is pronounced against Babylon. Hallelujah. We read in verse 46, at the noise of the taking of Babylon, the earth is moved and the cry is heard among the nations. Okay, so God says that when Babylon is taken, the whole earth is going to be moved. The Hebrew word for that is shaken. We see that here. Hallelujah. Let's look at the Hebrew word for moved. Ra'ash. Okay. The earth shake. The sky. Okay. Okay. This is to move, to quake, to shake, to tremble. Okay. This is an earthquake. Okay. When Babylon is destroyed, Jeremiah says, the whole earth is going to shake. Okay. The whole earth is going to shake. And of course, Babylon falls once the temple in heaven is open. That is why we read about the destruction of Babylon in Revelation chapter 14. Hallelujah. We see that the second angel, when he comes out of the temple, there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Okay, Babylon is going to be totally shaken. Hallelujah. That is why the second angel announces it. Okay, he doesn't announce that China has fallen. He doesn't announce that Russia has fallen. He doesn't announce that Australia has fallen. He doesn't announce that Africa has fallen. He doesn't announce that Europe has fallen. He announces that Babylon is fallen. That great city, okay? Why would, out of all the cities on the planet that we know today, why is Babylon singled out? Out of all the cities, why is Babylon continually singled out, okay? Because the reason why it is because Babylon is the one who's in control at the time that the temple in heaven is open, okay? At the time when the temple in heaven is open, Babylon the Great is in charge of the whole world. That's why we read in Revelation chapter 17, hallelujah, Revelation chapter 17, we see that Babylon reigns over the kings of all the earth. Revelation 17, 18. And the woman which you saw is that great city, which reigns over the kings of the earth. Okay, and we know that the woman is none other than Babylon the Great. 17:4, and the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. So the woman who reigns over the kings of the earth is Babylon the Great. Okay? And in my other teachings, I've went over how Babylon the Great sits on seven mountains. The seven mountains are the seven continents of this world. Babylon the Great is in charge of all the world through her military might, okay? Through her military domination, okay? And we know that at the time when Babylon falls, there's going to be a seventh king in charge of her. And I went over that in my teachings previously. And we know that that seventh king is none other than Donald Trump, okay? Donald Trump is the seventh king. We read in Revelation 17:10 that there are seven kings, five are fallen, and one is, the other is not yet come. And when he comes, he must continue a short space. Okay, the five that had fell at the time that John had written this in 90 AD was Alexander the Great. He was the first one. And then his four generals who followed him, who had the kingdom divided up into four different territories, they were the four who make up the five, including Alexander the Great. They had already died by the time John had written the Revelation in 90 AD. And then John said that there was one who was already on the scene. One is, that was Caesar and the Roman Empire. But then John said that there is another one who has not yet come. Okay, so there's going to come one at the end of the age who's going to be over Babylon the Great. And when he comes, he's going to continue a short space. And so the one who had not yet come, and when he comes, he must continue a short space, he's the seventh king. Donald Trump is the seventh king. He was 70 years old, 7 months and 7 days when he took office. He was 700 days old at the time when Israel became a nation again in May 14th, 1948. He won the Electoral College votes over Hillary Clinton by 77 votes, okay? So the number seven is connected to him in so many ways. You could do an easy Google search or a YouTube video search to find more out about how the number seven is connected to Donald Trump. But the point is that the great city, who is Babylon the Great, United States of America, will be overthrown in 1 hour and in 1 day. And the fall of Babylon is what begins the great and terrible day of the Lord. Okay? And it comes when the 70 years are completed. Okay? The 70 years. Okay? When the 70 years, the 70 years, when they come to their fulfillment, okay, Babylon the Great is going to be judged, as well as the whole world, okay? And then we read about the cup of wrath that God tells Jeremiah to send to all the nations, okay? So remember, God said that when the 70 years are completed, he's going to bring upon the land of Babylon all the words that he has uttered against it, even everything that is written in this book, okay, which Jeremiah prophesied against all the nations, okay? And so here we see just a little bit of what he had written in this book. And this is the cup of the Lord's wrath. And, you know, he goes on to name all these different nations, okay? And the final nation, he says, is the king of Babylon, okay? But look at what he says, okay? Because this is all going to be fulfilled. This hasn't happened yet. All these nations have not drank of the cup of the Lord's wrath yet. They only drink of the cup of the Lord's wrath once the cloudy day begins, okay? And so we read about this here in verse 28. This is what God says. And if they refuse to accept the cup from your hand to drink, then you shall say to them, thus says the Lord of hosts, you must drink. For behold, I begin to work disaster at the city that is called by my name. And shall you go unpunished? You shall not go unpunished. For I am summoning a sword against all the inhabitants of the earth, declares the Lord of hosts. So God is sending a sword against all the inhabitants of the earth. And look what happens when he does that. This is what's going to happen when the cloudy day comes, when the temple in heaven is open. You therefore shall prophesy against them all these words and say to them, the Lord will roar from on high, and from his holy habitation utter his voice. He will roar mightily against his fold, and shout like those who tread grapes against all the inhabitants of the earth. The clamor will resound to the ends of the earth, For the Lord has an indictment against the nations. He is entering into judgment with all flesh. And the wicked he will put to the sword, declares the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, behold, disaster is going forth from nation to nation, and a great tempest is stirring from the farthest parts of the earth. And those pierced by the Lord on that day shall extend from one end of the earth to the other. They shall not be lamented or gathered or buried. They shall be dung on the surface of the ground. Okay, so this is the cloudy day. This is the cloudy day, okay, when God roars from on high. Okay, we know that on the day when the temple in heaven is open, we know that this is what's going to happen. Based on 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 through 18, the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout. He's going to roar from on high. That's what the Bible says. We just read it in Jeremiah 25. The Lord will roar from on high. He will, and from his holy habitation, utter his voice. Okay? We know that 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 through 18 says that the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. So when the Lord descends from heaven with a shout, this is this. The Lord will roar from on high, and from his holy habitation utter his voice. He will roar mightily against his fold and shout, and shout, and shout, okay, and shout. This is what the Bible says. And in my last teachings, we went over the seven thunders. The seven thunders declare what happens when he shouts in more detail, okay? And we see the seven thunders in the book of Psalms, hallelujah. The book of Psalms gives us a picture of the seven thunders, Psalm 29. Okay, because when the temple in heaven is open, there's going to be seven thunders that utter their voices. And the seven thunders is the Lord who roars from on high. And those seven thunders will bring devastation to the world. Okay, on top of the four winds being released. Okay, the four winds are being held back by the four cherubim who take the throne of God wherever he wills. The four living creatures who surround the throne of God, and they have the wheels inside of wheels. But on the day that the temple in heaven is open, those four cherubim will release the four winds. The four winds will come upon the whole earth. Okay, and remember what Isaiah 66:15 tells us. For behold, the Lord will come with fire and with his chariots like a whirlwind to render his anger with fury and his rebuke with flames of fire. Okay, that's all happening on the cloudy day. When God rides on his chariot, when Jesus, Yeshua, comes on the clouds of heaven, okay, in the clouds is the whirlwind. And the whirlwind, like a tornado, is going to sweep across the earth. And he says in that day, the Lord, he's going to kill everyone. There's going to be bodies from end to end, from one end of the earth to the other. They shall not be lamented or gathered or buried. They shall be dung on the surface of the ground. Well, he's not going to kill everyone, but the Bible says that one-fourth of the world's population is going to die on that day when the fourth horse rides, when the fourth horse of Revelation rides. One-fourth of humankind will die. We see that here. When the fourth seal, when that's manifested, this is what he says, and power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth. Okay, over the fourth part of the earth, one-fourth of the earth is going to die. Okay, one-fourth of the earth is going to die on the cloudy day when the temple in heaven is open. Okay, one-fourth of humankind is going to die on this day. You see, because then you still got the seven angels who stand before God. They're coming out as well. And the first four will blow their trumpets, okay, which is connected to the hailstones, okay, the hailstones, the kicking out of Satan, wormwood coming to the ground, coming to the earth, okay. Then you still have You still have Michael the archangel. He's coming down, okay? And these other two angels, the three angels of Revelation 14, including Michael, they're coming out, okay? And then you have the largest earthquake in human history occurring. Remember, we read about that in Jeremiah 50:46, that when Babylon falls, the whole earth will shake. Okay? We read about that in Jeremiah chapter 50, verse 46. Hallelujah. Let's just go there right quick before I end this teaching. Jeremiah 50:46, the greatest earthquake in human history, occurs at the time that Babylon falls. At the noise of the taking of Babylon, the earth is moved, and the cry is heard among the nations. Okay, we know the cry are those in Revelation 18. The cry is Revelation 18 when everyone weeps and wails, when everybody says, alas, alas. Okay, and the kings of the earth who have committed fornication and live deliciously with her shall bewail her and lament for her, when they shall see the smoke of her burning, standing afar off for the fear of her torment, saying, alas, alas, that great city Babylon, that mighty city, for in 1 hour is your judgment come. Okay? And that great shaking of Babylon, it will produce the greatest earthquake in human history. We read about that here in Revelation 16. Okay, starting at verse 18, and there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake. Such was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great. And the great city was divided into three parts. And the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon came in remembrance before God, to give unto her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. And every island fled away, and the mountains were not found. And there fell upon men a great hail out of heaven, every stone about the weight of a talent. And men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, for the plague thereof was exceeding great. Okay, so this is the sixth seal. Okay, this is Gog and Magog, Ezekiel 38. Okay, this is the shaking of the heavens and the earth. Okay, this is the day when the temple in heaven is open. Okay, this is the day of sudden destruction. Okay, and so it's been 23 years since Comet Shoemaker Levy 9. Jeremiah chapter 25 tells us that for 23 years, Jeremiah preached, but the people did not listen. And so once those 23 years were up, the judgment began. And so here we are on the cusp of the 23 years being up. The year 5777, we're on the precipice of the 70 years. Remember back to Zechariah 1. The question from the angel was, how long will you have no mercy on Jerusalem and the cities of Judah, against which you have been angry these 70 years? The 70 years are up. No matter which date you pick, you want to take the 29th of November, 1947? Okay? It's been 70 years since the partition plan that the United Nations gave. Or you want to take May 14th, 1948. Okay, we're coming up to the 70-year anniversary in a couple months. The 5th of Iyar, 5708, was the Hebrew calendar date. 70 years from that date brings us to this date. The 5th of Iyar will be Friday, the 20th of April, 2018. Okay, so we're right in the middle. We're right in the middle of the two dates. You want to pick November 29th, 1947? Well, we've already arrived at the 70-year mark. You want to take it to the official date when the 70-year anniversary will be? That comes Friday, the 20th of April, 2018. And we know that this happened right after the 70-year anniversary of the UN Partition 181. This happened on the 21st of December, when the whole world came against Israel, when they rejected President Trump's recognition of Jerusalem as Israel's capital. Okay, the whole world was against it. Okay, so it's not too long, my friends. The 70 years is almost up. And one day real soon, Yeshua is going to crack open the heavens and he's going to rain down judgment upon a world that has rejected him. starting in Israel, extending all the way to the ends of the earth, and totally destroying the United States of America. But at the same time, God will rapture his church. He will take us up into the Father's house, and we will find shelter from the storm. The question is, do you know him? The question is, do you believe him? The question is, are your feet planted on the rock? You see, because the Bible tells us in Matthew 7, that there's a wise and that there are foolish builders. God says that if you hear his words and you put them into practice, you'll be like a wise person who will build their house on a rock, so that when the rain does come and the streams rise and the winds blow and beat against your house, it's not going to fall because you had a foundation, and that foundation is the rock, and that rock is Jesus. You see, but if you're not planted on the rock, you're going to have your house on the sand. And if your house is on the sand, you're going to be likened to a foolish person. Because when the rain does come, and it's coming, and when the streams rise, they will rise. And when the winds blow, they will blow. And beat against your house that's planted on the sand, you're going to have a great ruin. Your house is going to come crashing down. Okay? Because the Lord is going to measure everyone's foundation on the day when he comes out of his temple. On the day when he comes out of his temple, he's going to measure everyone's foundation. Hallelujah. And we see the measuring of his foundation in Amos chapter 7. Hallelujah. In Amos chapter 7, the visions are given with the locust, then the fire, and then the plumb line. But we have to read it and understand it backwards. Okay? First it comes the plumb line, then comes the fire, then comes the locust. Okay? When Amos saw the Lord standing beside a wall with the plumb line, in his hand, the Lord said to Amos, "What do you see?" And Amos said, "A plumb line." Then the Lord said, "Behold, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass by them. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste, and I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword." Okay, so the Lord, who is standing beside a wall with a plumb line measures the edge, the vertical line of a structure to see if it's straight. Okay, and so the Lord is measuring everyone's foundation, everyone's house to see if it's straight. Okay, that's the Lord coming out of the temple to measure everyone's foundation to see if it's planted on the rock or if it's planted on the sand. Okay, and so here we see it right here, that this is what happens first. The Lord comes to measure everyone's foundation. We see the same measuring in Habakkuk chapter 6, Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 6, when God comes out of his temple, when he stands up. This is God. He stood and measured the earth. Okay, he measured the earth with the plumb line. He beheld and drove asunder the nations, and the everlasting mountains were scattered. The perpetual hills did bow. His ways are everlasting. This is the sixth seal when he measures the earth, when he stands up, okay, and when he drives asunder the nations, and the everlasting mountains are moved at his presence. Okay, this is the sixth seal. This is Gog and Magog, the destruction of Babylon the Great, okay, when he stands up to measure the earth. Same thing as Amos chapter 7 with the plumb line. And then after the plumb line comes the fire. It happens right in conjunction with him coming out of his place. When the Lord comes out of heaven, when he measures everyone's foundation, okay, he's going to send fire. And this is what the Lord God showed me. Behold, the Lord God was calling for a judgment by fire, and it devoured the great deep and was eating up the land. Then I said, "O Lord God, please cease. How can Jacob stand? He is so small." The Lord relented concerning this. "This also shall not be," saith the Lord God. Okay, when God comes out of his place to rapture those who are planted on the rock, he's also going to send a fire. And that fire is going to burn up all the green grass on the earth. We see that in Revelation 8, when the first four trumpets are sounded, the first one, the first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of trees was burnt up, and all green grass was burnt up. Okay, so all the green grass is going to be burnt up. A third part of the trees are going to be burnt up. Okay, because God is sending a fire. He's sending a fire on the cloudy day. He's called for a judgment by fire. And it's going to devour the great deep. And it's going to eat up the land. Okay, but that's not it. You see, because the Lord, he relents. Okay, that judgment of the cloudy day, which encompasses the first four trumpets, okay, there's a pause. There's a pause after the first four trumpets. And we see the pause in verse 13 of Revelation 8. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, "Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels, which are yet to sound." Okay, so there's a pause right here. And the pause makes way for Revelation 9, the fifth trumpet, which is the trumpet of the locusts, the creatures from the bottomless pit. And that's what we see in Amos chapter 7, verse 1. This is what the Lord God showed me. Behold, he was forming locusts when the latter growth was just beginning to sprout. And behold, it was the latter growth after the king's mowings. When they had finished eating the grass of the land, I said, "O Lord God, please forgive. How can Jacob stand? He is so small." The Lord relented concerning this. "It shall not be," said the Lord. Okay, so the locusts, they come after the king's mowings. The king's mowings is the rapture, when Yeshua comes out of heaven, when he takes his sickle and he swings it on the earth and he raptures the saints, when he raptures those who are ready. He's mowed the earth. He's mowed the earth. The king's mowings have come. The harvest has come. Okay, the harvest has come, and those who are ready are taken to into the Father's house. Okay, but after that, after the cloudy day, after the pause, remember Revelation 8 tells us there's a pause after the first four trumpets. The next thing that happens after that pause is Revelation 9. During the tribulation, the fifth trumpet will blow. Sometime after this pause, after the cloudy day, there's going to be a pause, okay? The Antichrist, he's going to rise up. He's going to make peace. He's going to make war with those who love the Lord. But there's a pause in the judgments for a little bit. But once the fifth trumpet sounds, then the locusts come. Okay, then the locusts come. Just like we see here in Amos chapter 7. The locusts come. Okay, the locusts come after the king's mowings, the locusts come. Okay? But remember, this vision is in reverse. First, it's the plumb line. First, the Lord measures everyone. He measures everyone's foundation. This is when he comes out of the temple. Then he also sends the fire. And then the locusts come. Okay? And that's the same thing that we see in Revelation. God comes out of the temple. He sends the fire. There's a pause. And then the locusts come. When the fifth angel sounds his trumpet, the locusts come. And God says in that day, this is what's going to happen if you're left behind. And in those days shall men seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. That's what's coming, my friends. Not too much longer. Not too much longer, my friends. The cloudy day is almost here. The cloudy day is almost here. But remember, this day comes suddenly. It's the day of sudden destruction. Okay? He's going to come out of his temple suddenly. And when he comes out of his temple suddenly, if you're not ready, if your foundation is not the rock, which is Christ Jesus himself, you're going to shake from his presence. And there's a 1 in 4 chance that you'll die. You'll die, and if you do die, you'll go straight to hell. Because Hades follows after death when the fourth horse rides, and one-fourth of the world is slated for destruction. But if you survive the king's mowings and you're left behind, you survive the greatest earthquake in human history, you survive the hailstones and coals of fire, you survive the presence of the Lord, even though you were shaken to your very core, to your very soul, you survived. There's going to be no time to contemplate. There's going to be no time to reflect. There's only going to be weeping, weeping, wailing, and howling in all streets. Cannibalism will be rampant. Every person for themselves. No more McDonald's, no more Carl's Jr., no more Wendy's, no more Starbucks, no more Walmart, no more Target, okay? No more Panera Bread, no more Chuck E. Cheese, no more Hollywood, no more basketball, no more football, no more baseball, no more hip-hop music, no more country, no more pop music, no more R&B, no more rock and roll, no more fun and games, okay? The tribulation is the worst time in human history. Everything that's familiar today will be familiar no more if you're left behind. You will enter into the worst time in human history, okay? Everyone will be bald-headed. Instead of well-set hair, baldness, okay? Baldness will be upon every head, okay? Baldness will be upon every head, okay? Everyone will be bald-headed, okay? From all the radiation, because World War III will also happen. All the radiation that will be in the air. All the fallout, okay? The whole earth is going to be shaken. Volcanic ash in the air. The world is going to be darkened. Okay, everyone's going to be bald-headed. Everyone's going to be wearing sackcloth. Okay, no more high fashion. No more fashion week in Paris, okay? No more Louis Vuitton and Gucci. No more of that, okay? No more. No more, okay? It's the cloudy day. It's the day of the Lord. The day of his fierce anger, okay? He's going to lay the land wholly desolate, okay? There's going to be nothing that is familiar today in that day, okay? The whole world is going to be broken. It's going to be broken up into pieces, the Bible says. And the fourth beast kingdom is going to be on the world. And demons and the angels, the fallen angels, are going to be manifested. No more is there going to be a veil, but the veil is going to be breached because Satan and all his demons will be cast to the earth for the tribulation. No more going to and fro for them. And once that happens, they're going to know that they only have a short time left. Therefore, they're going to wreak havoc on the earth. They're going to wreak havoc like the world has never seen havoc. Okay? And if you're left behind, the sound of the fear and the pit and the snare will be upon you. Okay? Those who flee from the sound of the fear will fall into a pit. And those who escape out of the midst of the pit will be caught in the snare. For behold, the windows from on high will be open, and the foundations of the earth will shake. Okay, it's the cloudy day, my friends. The cloudy day is no joke. It's no joke. It's no laughing matter. When the temple in heaven is open and you're not caught up, woe unto your soul. Woe. Woe, woe. That's why the angel says it. If you survive the cloudy day, this is the only thing that's going to go in your head. Woe, woe, woe. Okay? You're going to have that on repeat. Woe, woe, woe. Okay? And the only way that you'll be able to escape from what's coming, the only way that you'll be able to escape from what's coming is to put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ today. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that he has risen from the dead, you shall be saved. That's it, that's all. We have to repent and believe the gospel, say yes to Jesus, and we can escape from this terrible judgment. Because if you're left behind and you somehow survive the cloudy day, the only way to escape in that day is to give your life. Literally, you're going to have to give up your head, because everyone who is left behind, who will not worship the beast, hallelujah, who will not take the mark of the beast, hallelujah, will be killed. It's a 99% possibility that you will be killed, okay? There's going to be some people who escape into the wilderness, okay, when the abomination of desolation happens in Israel, but you might not be in Israel, you know? I don't know where you'll be if you're left behind, but there will be a place of safety once the abomination of desolation happens. But I want to roll the dice with that. You want to get out now. You want to get out when the temple in heaven is open, because most likely if you are left behind and you survive the cloudy day, you're going to die. If you refuse the mark of the beast, you're going to die. You're going to die. There's nowhere to hide, okay? Satan and all his demons, supernatural creatures, they're going to be manifested, and they're going to hunt you. They're going to hunt you down like dogs. They're going to hunt down all the Christians like dogs, okay? And all those who come to faith during the tribulation, they're going to be hunted, okay? And Satan, he's going to have power to do it, because God is going to allow him to do it. Okay? But you can escape all that if you give your heart to Jesus Christ right now. Don't wait, my friends, because the cloudy day is almost here. Thank you for joining me with this teaching. I give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor, Heavenly Father. You are worthy to be praised. In Jesus' name, amen.